praises shall continually be in our mouth. Hallelujah. We thank God for this another day.
Hallelujah.
That we might rejoice.
Hallelujah.
And be glad.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
This has been a long and tiresome week. The majority of this week has been spent visiting my 100-year-old grandmother. Having received word on Monday that her health was rapidly declining. She had been hospitalized. Her body was frail. Her voice was faint. But through it all, she kept giving God the praise. After Monday, many would have thought that and right to Doctor's Hospital was her earthly resting place. But once again, my grandmother fought her way back, and she is back at the nursing home.
Amen.
Amen. Weak, but full of wisdom. She has always been a puller of strength, not only for me, but for our entire family. So this week, once again, she helped me put my life and this ministry back into perspective.
Uh-huh.
One of her stellar statements has become, I don't know why the Lord has kept it around for so long, but it got to be for something.
Amen.
And when I think about the church, holistically, I wonder why God has kept it around for so long. Respectfully, I don't believe what we now call churches is what God intended for spiritual fellowship.
Yes, sir.
I'm appalled and often annoyed when I go into holy places and it's more like Showtime at the Apollo. When every choir is trying to outdo the other one, every solo is trying to hold a note a little longer than the first one. When one praise dance is trying to outdance the next one, and when deacons are trying to outpray each other, and preachers are trying to outpreach each other,
can't do it.
But nobody's trying to outkill each other.
Hello.
When every service has a finale of who's the biggest giver, I begin to wonder, is God in this? I literally had to stop going to leadership conferences because they have become a Future Businessmen of America conference.
Say so.
And I began to question whether God was even in it any longer. I recall being the president of a Ministers Alliance in the city that I pastored in, and we decided to get a particular nationally known evangelist for our citywide revival. And in his response to our request, his secretary sent a three-page pre-proposal listing of litany of domains. He wanted a limo service to pick him up. He could only stay at a five-star hotel and be taken to five-star restaurants to eat. He could only drink a certain kind of water. His expenses would include two aides that traveled with him wherever he went. He would not and could not be committed to speak with any other groups prior to or even after he agreed services. And I believe that whatever, amen. I believe that whatever we do as a body should be done with a spirit of excellence. I believe that.
Amen.
But our customs ought not resemble the customs of the world. The church has a problem when pastors are just like superstars. When pastors can no longer be bothered by people, personal jets to keep them separated from the masses. We can only drive luxury automobiles, live in the best neighborhood. The danger is that when these things become our motivation, when greed becomes our seed, we build and develop that will resemble pimps in the pulpit and players in the
pew.
I know it's tight money, right? the church and then they tag on in the name of Jesus. When preachers walk around churches with pompous attitudes, when we come to the pulpit with muscle shirts on and tight clothing, we have lost humility in the pulpit, we have lost integrity in the pulpit. I believe that many of these ministers do not begin with these intentions when they got started.
Do not pass me back.
Amen.
Say.
When I started this ministry, some 6 years ago, I strongly felt that one of the key qualities would be accessibility to people.
All right,
amen.
Yes, sir.
There are a group of people in the kingdom who need a pastor who's still accessible to them. It might not be you. You may not never need to talk to your pastor face to face or shake his head or hear his voice beyond the microphone. But there's some people that need a hand on this. Jesus had a ministry for individuals.
Yeah.
And not only that, but he always had time for individuals.
Right there,
on
time.
No mega church, but individuals. Yeah. No corporate guests, but individuals. No bodyguards or almost barriers, but individuals.
I don't need no bodyguard. I got less than 100 members. If somebody try to do something to me, I'm gonna try to leave
time. Amen.
Mr. Neal, he's my armor bearer. I don't need no bodyguard. You think I need a bodyguard running on me? No five-star hotels and business sales team. You can you imagine the Bible with no story of the woman who Jesus met at the well? I mean, he took time out to talk to the woman at the well.
That's it.
Bridget had five husbands, and the one she had then won't even hurt, but he took time out to talk to her. Can you imagine the Bible without the woman who touched the hem of his garment? Can you imagine this woman trying to touch the hem of Jesus' garment and an armor bearer or a bodyguard walking up to her? What you doing?
Hold up.
Now this woman needs a touch.
Yeah.
There was a mother whose son had died and stopped him and he was on his way to heal another parent's child. But Jesus was concerned about the individual. Blind people who cried out. Demonics that no one cared about throughout the Bible. Jesus, in case after case, a very busy Jesus took time for out an individual like this lowly tax collector.
Yeah.
As preachers, we can't become too busy that we can't do what Jesus did.
Say so.
Jesus is our role model. We too busy to visit the sick, shut in. Too busy to visit the hospital. When I need it there, I've got to go to the hospital to see a young man that just got shot. He's looking for me to be there. I expect to be there.
Yes, sir.
Hear about how busy I am. Too busy to conduct funerals for your own members.
Amen.
Too busy to perform wedding ceremony.
Amen.
Too busy to be involved in local issues
Jesus could have used a skew gun. I'm too busy for the man in Africa. I'm too busy for this person being here. I'm too busy for this man or another one else. He made it important because he was a God of individual. Yeah. He didn't have no electric car. He didn't have no airplane. He didn't have no helicopter. All he had was a pair of sandals and a donkey. You can't convince me that everybody's too busy to do ministry. You can't even answer a phone call and you tell me you need an I-5. You don't even need an I-1. Zacchaeus was a man of high standing, but Jesus looked up and told Zacchaeus, come on down. Zacchaeus made haste and came down. But what a terrible position to be in, is to be dangerous position higher than Christ. Some of y'all forget it. You never want to find yourself looking down on Christ. I know you're a bishop, but come on now. I know that you're an apostle, but come on now. I know that you're a prophet, but come on now. I know that you're a prophetess, but come on now. I know that you're a man. But come on now, I know that your doctor so-and-so barely made it through high school, but come on now.
Come on down here with me.
I know that you speak in tongues, but come on, I'm trying to get through it here, baby. Just wait a minute. Hey, come on down. Zacchaeus came down because if you don't come down, God has a way of bringing you down.
Thank you.
You move it over the long wheel. Take the wings up there. Come down. Come on, man. So God can use you. Come on down. So God can bless you. Come on down. So that God can anoint you. Come on down. So God can save you. Come on down. So God can save you. Now, somebody need to come down this morning. You don't know me. It's a cedar tree. You come on down. Come on down. God can bless you. Stuff for God on your child and your family, and then what if God took all that stuff from you? Thank God for where you are.
That's all.
God wants you to serve Him.
That's all.
But some of you need to come on down. Come on down. Stop thinking so much of yourself that you think so little of your ministry. Jesus died on Calvary's cross.
Yes, for me. For me.
Bled, suffered, and died.
Yes, well, me, you.
They stretched him wide and they hung him high. But he didn't stay here.
Thank you. He didn't stay nothing.
You know why? Because he knew he'd come on back. They laid him by a tomb. Put him in a sand. Because he knew he had come to serve you and I.
He
could have called for angels on a thousand hills. But he didn't. He came down. You and I. What's going to make you come back? What's going to make you come back? What's going to make you serve Him? I promise you that I will serve Him till I die. Won't you come back? There's somebody right now. You're about a church, I'm about a fellowship. You need to come on down.
Yeah.
There's some of you in the church not doing anything. You need to roll up your sleeves and you need to come on down.
Yeah. Say so.
The Lord has worked for you and I. That's what I'm saying. Surrender your life to Jesus. You without a church home, a church family. You desire to be a part of this fellowship. Come on, man. Maybe you need to be a part of a hands-on ministry. A ministry where you can touch your pastor. Your pastor can touch you. God wants to use you, but you gotta come on down. The door to the church open right now.